My entire life, I have questioned everything. Today, that's what I'm here to do. Have open, honest, sometimes difficult conversations. Welcome to my chronic curiosity. What's up, everybody? I just want to do a real quick intro to this next video to do two things. One, as custom dictates, Mr. Anthony will be joining us as usual, and also Cass, my lovely wife, will also be joining us to discuss the disengagement of voters and on the political scene and what drives that around people. So, you know, maybe you'll relate to this a little bit, but also to clear up one more thing, during this coming podcast and the most recent one, number four, I believe it was, we have discussed a gentleman by the name of Brett Weinstein, and we have mispronounced his name over and over again as Weinstein, and it is actually Weinstein. So I wanted to clear that up so there was no confusion. And you'll hear that in the coming one as well. But in the future, if you do not know who Brett Weinstein is, I suggest you take a look. What he has experienced in the last few years is interesting and kind of foreshadowing what we're experiencing today in mid-2020. So he's also an extremely intelligent person and educated, much unlike myself. But he has some very interesting ideas, which is Unity 2020, which is what we're going to discuss coming out. Thanks. Enjoy.
Well, that's so funny.
You're really on it.
Yeah.
You throwing up gang signs, or did you tell someone to steal third, or was that the shocker you just gave?
No, I mean, I can get one of those little clippy things, the little snappy things, if you want me to, if I'm more official.
Take one.
Yeah.
I like it.
It's to sync the audio and video up.
I like it.
Smarty pants.
I wasn't being an ass.
You were totally being an ass.
I was a little.
Yeah. So we got Cass and Tone. Tone, he's always here.
Yeah.
So it's fun.
I'm always here. I'm just upstairs.
Yeah.
I'm here.
Right. So I know not historically, because I wouldn't say there's a history to it, because it's only been like four episodes. So, but
habitually, is that the word? Are you a habitual line stepper, Fred?
Yeah. You know, we've talked a lot about a politics and all that junk, and this is going to be right along those lines. And you know, I know Toni, you and I have discussed it of, you know, going down different paths, which we have
ad nauseum.
Yeah. So we have plenty of things set up, but particularly, you know, we had this conversation, or at least the start of the conversation the other day, and I think it's a good time to have at least one more of those political conversations, because...
Is it more than just the tip?
Yeah, more than
just...
Yeah.
You always need more than just the tip.
Yeah.
Ow!
Particularly with what's going on with the Unity 2020. And I know we've discussed that in different things. And
dude, all I can think about anytime any human being from here on out says Unity is Dave Chappelle, the Rick James and Charlie Murphy, when he has that ring on and he says, Unity.
I don't even remember that one.
Oh, it's awesome.
I know. I remember when he's rubbing his feet all over Eddie Murphy's couch. I remember that.
Choose your words wisely.
Yeah, no, yeah, I'm not going to choose them at all. I'm just going to avoid them.
Smart man.
Yeah, but I think particularly, you know, going back to Unity 2020, not the Rick James version.
Rick James, bitch.
Yeah.
We need a Jamie.
That's
like,
Rick.
Like a rogue Jamie could like pull that up and be like, oh, blah, 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 here's that YouTube video. And we could watch Dave Chappelle.
Yeah, it's probably best that we don't watch Dave Chappelle.
We're not.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
I thought we were going to take this to the next level.
Well, yeah. Well, there's some things. There's guidelines you have to follow.
Yeah, I don't know that you can play some of those things on YouTube. If it ever makes it on air, they get censored or get pulled. Or
yeah, it's yeah, they're guidelines. And well, everything gets pulled nowadays. Even Unity 2020. Full circle.
Full circle. There you go.
All the way back.
Full circle.
No. Yeah. So I think it kind of started out as, I was asking both of you about the disengagement of American citizens these days and politics and all those things, because, I'll be honest, I just really started, and we talked about this the other day, getting back into, not even back into things, but taking a weird deep dive recently. And just realizing the potential of what could happen and what is happening, and how most people don't understand or even care what's happening. Cause I used to be like that for a long time. You know, I haven't voted in, it's been 16 years since I voted. And I know you just said the other day that was last 2016 was the first time you had voted. And yeah. I think that was the same for you. So I think it's just kind of a neat idea that, you know, most of the people that come in contact with, a lot of people don't vote at all or even care what's going on.
55%.
Yeah. Well, I think it was in like 2016, it was like 53% of.
Didn't vote.
Did not vote. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So just some interesting thoughts. I just didn't know, background wise, I guess up until 2016, why hadn't you voted up until that point, and what made you vote in 2016?
Cassie, you want to take this first, or you mean to take this?
I don't think it was one thing in particular. I feel like either I was old enough to understand the potential urgency of where we were at in 2016. I mean, not that we had a whole lot to choose from with her or him, but I don't know if that became prevalent because I was older and I was more mature and we have a child and just, you know, more things, you know, or if it was, you know, I can't bitch about something I don't actively partake in. Not that I really bitch about it anyways, but I don't think it's ever one thing, you know?
Right.
You know, it's not something that's really taught in school. I wasn't really taught how you register, how you vote, you know? And it's a lame excuse because it's not hard, but to have to do it, it's kind of like,
Yeah, that's kind of funny, too. You mentioned it's not taught in schools, and it just made me think, like, at least on a real big picture, some of the most important things are the people that run your life, the government, and how you handle your money. Cause that's kind of nowadays, like you have, cause no one, you know, lives off the land. They don't teach any of that shit in school.
How to file taxes.
Yeah.
How to run a business.
You mean the important shit so you can actually survive instead of just preparing kids for college?
All right.
We should prepare them for life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's pretty.
I speak about that all the time.
It's pretty incredible. When you go back and look at what you were learning in school, and it's like, why? What did that do me any good? And there's some stuff that did, but.
And they tell us all the time, kids are the future. Well, then fucking prepare us for the future.
Right.
And we have to figure all this stuff out.
Preparing you for college. They're not preparing you for your life, basically. Mm-hmm. Or they would give you what you just said, that things that are important, that, you know, teach you a financial education. Mm-hmm. They teach you, you don't have to go to college. You could actually do something like skilled trade. And then, skilled trade. Those people make tons of money, actually. Mm-hmm. And they don't have tons of debt. They don't get a liberal arts degree. Right. And you go, I'm $20,000 in debt with no job. Oh, yeah, that's right. You chose that.
Right. Mm-hmm. I don't know how you get a degree in liberal arts. Like, what are those people supposed to do? I guess, like,
exactly.
Like, and what do they go into that? Like, thinking
Antifa, probably. Or however
that,
you said
it. Yeah, it didn't work out so well for that last guy.
Who that was
brutal.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
hold on.
But to go back to that real quick, it's not hard to register to vote.
No, it's super
at
easy.
At all. They tell you where to go. You stand in line for like 5 minutes. Who knows with COVID? I don't know. But I was in and out. I felt proud that I voted.
You felt like a responsible adult.
Yeah. You know, it's a little thing.
I'm
it's
adulting
like,
today.
Yeah. Like when you have an umbrella and it's raining, like, oh, adulting. Yeah.
I just feel weird. If I were by myself and I had an umbrella.
The only time I have an umbrella is it's in my drink, so I don't care if you think that's girly. My ties for the win.
Yeah, it makes you feel fancy. Only if I'm on the beach. That's right. Only if I'm on the beach. So, and to your point, it is super easy because I actually re-registered because I didn't know this year. And it was literally like a 10-minute process, if that. So it is super easy. I just don't, people don't think about it, and we can get more into that. But so, what was your deal, Toni? Because I mean, you're seems like somebody on the surface that would think about that kind of thing more often than not.
I like how he says on the surface. He's like, know. He's got him fooled.
Yeah,
you
maybe
tricked him all, chief, you slick son of a bitch. Little one flew over the cuckoo's nest. Reference for you. I think it goes back to I took a college class when I was a senior. I took a couple college classes when I was a senior. And our poli sci teacher, what was his name? I can't think of his name, but he was kind of an interesting guy. I can't explain it. He was obviously far smarter than me in that subject, but he basically said, guys, your vote really doesn't matter. And he sat there and he broke it down as to why it didn't really matter. And I was like, well, I mean, I guess if I'm going to be a good steward of my time, why would I waste it going to vote if my vote truly doesn't matter? And then I think I got older and just forgot about that, or I got naive and stupid or whatever. And I was like, okay, I'm going to go vote. But I did have a business. So I'm like, oh, I got to pay attention to these things called taxes. And I'm like, let me look at those. And I'm like, well, I don't know. Maybe my vote does matter. And I honestly just, as shallow as it sounds, I kind of just wanted to see who else was voting. Who's crawling out of the woodwork. And I saw some interesting characters. It wasn't quite, I'd say it was like the Wayne County Fair light.
Ooh.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
Where did you vote?
It was down in the holler.
Yeah, where's your district, man?
And I knew, yeah, you could tell how every one of those people were voting. Oh, yeah.
They just look, I'm like, you guys don't have to vote. We got you. Yeah. We got you. I'll mark you down.
Yeah. just to watch people, it was interesting. But no, just I kind of looked at their platforms and I was like, how is this going to affect me? How is this going to affect, going back to what you said, Cass, your family? And then I just genuinely am not a fan of Hillary Clinton and the Clintons and all that they stand for and the power that they have. And I'm not saying other people don't have just as much power, but it's, I mean, there's jokes about, oh, don't say that around the Clintons. You might die.
Right. And those jokes aren't just being like, they're not just internet memes anymore.
No, there's truth in that, in jest, and it's right there. So
yeah,
I just genuinely didn't like the other option. And I was like, well, I mean, I don't know that the other option is that much better, but I was like, I kind of played that long game, if you will. And I'm like, what happens if she's in office? Like, what's that going to look like? And I was like, I don't want to see that happen.
Right.
I don't really want to see that happen. And we're kind of right. We're right back there.
Yeah.
We're right back there. Two just shit candidates. Shit candidates. And I'm not saying that Trump hasn't done plenty of things that he said he was gonna do, or partially done. We discussed some of those, but it just goes back to what we said about the president of the United States and what that position truly means
and what it should.
Yeah,
what it should appear as.
Having, yeah, like we said, just a slight amount, just a modicum of empathy and just being able to care. And for me, it's just so, not that it's not funny, because it's hilarious. reading some of those tweets, but not from the president of the United States. Like that's a comic. That's some shit you read on Twitter or something like that. And just the fact that he even responds to that stuff, I'm like, dude, you're the most powerful man in the world, and you care what someone thinks. You care about someone commenting on you tripping, like.
Right. Well, I think it goes back to the level of narcissism.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
But the weird thing is I think like we discussed on the last episode too, he likes it, and that's that he like feeds off of it. I almost made a really bad joke there.
Yeah, no, seriously, if you looked up the definition of zero fucks.
Oh, he's, that's him.
His face is sure. In that dictionary under that
yeah,
definition.
Yeah, and that's like, I'll give him props for that. But going back to one thing that you said, the not mattering, because that's what it was for me. The very first, I was eligible to vote literally months before a presidential election. And I registered, and that was the first and only time I have voted. Because then after that, I was a very...
What year was that?
Oh, 16 years ago. So it would have been 2004. It would have been the re-election of Bush, right? Yeah, because wasn't Bush... He was elected in 2000, right? And then he served to 2000, 2008, I think, right? Yeah, because it would have been 2000, 2008.
Yeah,
and
he
then
did too.
Obama was 2008 to 16. So I voted in the second re-election of Bush, W. I am the decider.
Nuclear.
I still use that. You fool me once. Shame on you. Fool me twice. What ain't gonna happen again? He had so many but at least he was like a grandpa funny and ridiculous and like
Yogi Bearism.
Yeah. But in between there, I was a very cynical person, and I got to the same point where I realized like my vote doesn't count. Like there's millions and millions of votes, and my one vote's not gonna count. But I think I've realized. I think a piece of that is kind of like the when you go to vote. And it's kind of like, I feel like we had a discussion before at one point where it was when you're doing what you say you're going to do and people see that, and it's, you may not know it, but the impact you have by just being the person you are. And I think voting is kind of, I think can be, there's a parallel I think that could be drawn with that.
Bro, did you just go Jerry Maguire on me? Who's coming with me?
Show me the money. Show me the money, Jerry.
That's all I know. Your human head weighs 6 pounds.
See, I didn't see all of that. Nice different angles. I like the, yeah.
Christ, if the human head weighs 6 pounds, what do you think Trump's head weighs?
Oh, it's 5.
That's generous. I'm just joking. What do you think Biden's weighs?
Oh, especially like 2.5.
Two and a half, maybe.
Yeah. Just there's nothing there.
Just Louis bodies all over the place in there.
I mean, it really does look like a deflating helium balloon. Just kind of like, yeah. I don't know where I was going.
Sorry. We're talking about bringing people on.
Voting. Yeah, so I think the voting aspect is, it's obviously, because a candidate can win the majority of the popular vote.
True.
And still lose the election by electoral votes. And I get that, and I understand how all that works. And I don't know if I disagree with her or not. I like the idea of it. But, I think it's that voting isn't just, that one vote. Because if that one vote tips the scales in an election, that's weird. But I think that even if it's, you go to work or you come home, or you're out somewhere, or people, hey, now I gotta go vote. I had to go vote, or I went and did this, or your kids see you voting as they grow up. I think that's where the voting piece of it actually has an impact.
Being a participant, and having some stake in our nation, mm-hmm. and then going, oh, I'm not just gonna complain about it. I'm gonna try and do something about it and make legitimate change.
Right, because that was always me. Like she said, like. Well, if you didn't vote, you can't complain. And that was my position as well. Like, well, fuck, I'm just not going to complain about it because I just don't care.
Yeah.
until this year, I feel like I got hit with a fucking sledgehammer, seeing the theoretical possibilities of what could be. Honestly, either way, it could get pretty rough either way. So that's kind of what got me looking into Unity 2020 in the articles of Unity.
That whistle pig's just not sitting too well with you.
So, and I know, obviously, both of you know about it at this point, mostly because I just keep talking about it and I hound you. But I think there's a lot of people that don't understand what's going on and the idea that this political duopoly, you know, what it has over us. And I don't know if you've kind of, I won't say open your eyes, because that's not the intent, but has the idea of Unity 2020 changed your thought process at all? Like, has it, because to me it was like, oh, wait, there is theoretical options out there that, like, that's, I guess, is the first time I've heard of an idea that was, hey, this actually sounds like it is something I could really get behind and push. Like, because I could never be a left or right, you know, real hardcore Republican Democrat, because I'm not hardcore Democrat or Republican. But maybe that's what it is, the Unity 2020 thing. And just to kind of break it down, I guess, it's the idea was put forth by Brett Weinstein, ooh, I think. And I still am not sure if we're pronouncing that right. We had this discussion.
Steinstein?
On the last one, yeah.
I feel like I heard it, Brett Weinstein.
And I've watched enough of his videos. I feel like I should know by now. And I've heard him talk to people.
But he talks with different people. They all have accents. Just like,
yeah.
What's his name? Peterson. His voice is so different. So everyone says something different. But anyways, continue.
So the idea, just to put it out there so people understand what I'm talking about, is that, you know, this control that the Democrats and Republicans have over the political process, and particularly that the road we're on now, that we either have to choose Biden or Trump. So the idea is that he put forth this kind of Hail Mary, in a sense, of why don't we have somebody that is politically center left and center right, and the idea is to draft these two candidates to run for president and vice president.
How did he pick, or how did they pick those six or however many there were?
So the process is, so his idea was that the people that they're going to draft, and it can't be someone that's, you know, wants to do it, because the core of it is they need to be patriotic. They need to, you know, have some kind of basis of, you know, that they really want to do something good for the country. Give me some. Yeah. So that's the idea of the draft piece, is it's not somebody that necessarily wants to do this, but these people would be so patriotic that if the American people said, hey, we need you, we want you, we have the capabilities of doing this, we want you to run. So they would almost have to do it. So what they did...
Wouldn't that be a breath of fresh air?
Oh my God. Dude, I keep thinking about it, and like, well, I'll get there.
Fred's half torqued right now.
I'll do it. Yeah, I'll get there. Like, so... What they did was they just opened, they had like preliminary, what's the word I'm looking for?
The word I'm looking for is, bro, I don't like your hand gestures. So there's microaggressions.
We can't censor those tone.
Yeah.
They're here.
I'm just joking.
Yeah. It's,
it's from something.
Yeah. The evergreen stuff. I can't think of the word I want. They were proposed. Proposed isn't the right word, but people, it's right there. put their names, basically said, hey, nominated. They were nominated by everybody that was part of, like, because you basically had to sign up for this list, and they were just, hey, like, as updates came out, they were, it was a nomination process where everyone put in their nominations of who they think should, you know, be drafted. So then they essentially took the top six people, and then put them on a list. And that originally was Dan Crenshaw, Tulsi Gabbard, Jesse Ventura, Jocko Willink, Andrew Yang, and William McRaven. So those are the top six people that were picked. And then just recently they held a rank choice vote. So what they did is they took by each person's kind of political standings and beliefs, they ranked them left or right. So there was three of each, and then they paired up one person from the left and one person from the right and all the combinations. So then the voting went in. I think it was last weekend. You went in and you voted for your, you know, what was your top two candidates and your second two candidates and your third, fourth, fifth, and sixth. So it presented every possible opportunity. And the voting was done. And then earlier, I think it was, I want to say it was Monday night or Tuesday night, they announced that their ticket would be Tulsi Gabbard and Dan Crenshaw. So that's kind of where they're at now. And now they're trying to get ballot access and all these things. But so going back to that idea is to have two people. So I think every single person on that ticket was in the military.
As they should be, in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, you don't get much more patriotic than serving your country.
You need to know what the fuck is going on.
Here's a sacrifice, my eye.
Yeah, Dan Crenshaw, the
how can you go wrong with someone with an eye patch or a chick who's been in the military?
And is a minority.
Yeah, so, yeah, she's
Indian.
Yeah, she's like, I think she's what, like half Indian, and then...
Well, so is Biden's vice president, but sometimes they say she's black.
Yeah, but she put a lot of people... Yeah, she,
it's black, that's a whole Indian, depends thing. On what minority
you're... Well, I'll tell you one thing Tulsi hasn't done is put thousands of people in jail for misdemeanors, and then joked about doing the same misdemeanor herself.
I bet she doesn't have scabs on her knees either.
Maybe there are. What's wrong with that?
Because she, never mind. Maybe that's why she's in the position she is. I mean, you got to use what you got to use.
Yeah, you got to do what you got to do, Ton.
Yeah,
I mean, Tulsi's got a little more respect than that.
No, absolutely. Hers were just done just because she wanted to, like not to get to where she was going to get. Ooh,
a weird turn.
No, there's nothing wrong.
Yeah.
Oh, that's really good.
Not bad.
The buffalo trees.
Yeah, the buffalo
better
trees.
Better than the benchmark in mine. Yeah. Are you sure it's not Bison Trace?
Oh, God.
We're not going to go
don't
there.
Don't let Les Parsons hear this.
Yeah, we don't need to go there. So that's the idea, and that's where they're at, is they've gotten to the point where they've nominated their ticket and see where it goes from here. They have to get ballot access across the nation. But the idea to me of having two people that I'd vote for either one of them.
As would I.
And but together, I'm like, literally, kind of gets me half torqued. Like to have two people, not only just one person that you, like, yeah, like, no, I like this presidential candidate, I'd vote for them. But going from, well, we got one presidential candidate that is an asshat, but the other presidential candidate might burn the country to the ground. You can decide which is which. I mean, either one. I mean, either side, they're going to have that description for either one of them. And, you know, how many years has it been where people continue to talk about voting for the lesser of two evils? So that's...
When did they decide which one is vice and which one is president out of those two?
Yeah, so that I don't know. I think they may have even said at one point, like, it's basically, we're going to flip a coin.
They did say they were going to flip a coin. And I think it's just going to be ruled as, I don't know if the right word is a biumvirate. Like back in ancient Rome, they had a triumvirate, which was like a three people that ruled and just equal ruling. And they did say a coin though. They did say, hey, we're going to do a coin toss. Who do you think is going to flip that coin?
Yeah, right. Who knows? But I think
Jocko.
Yeah, Jocko. Yeah, right. That's not a bad idea.
And then he just smashes it in his bare hands afterwards.
Yeah. Who's going to tell him no?
Yeah, I wouldn't mess with the guy. I think the idea is to flip a coin, because the idea after that is if they were to get elected, they would run again, but flipped. So if...
Bro, are they running again, or are they run again?
I'm sorry. What are you?
Oh, love it, bro.
Maybe.
No, I genuinely enjoy the way you said that.
She's made fun of me my entire life for that.
Well, I'm sorry. I'm not a bandwagon jumper, but
you didn't know.
I kind of led that one right there. So no, I genuinely like when people pronounce words in a different way.
Yeah, I mean, I don't,
it sounded so southern, and I southern southern men tell better jokes. That's what they say. So
I'm not sure what that's supposed to mean.
That's Dan Leach.
Oh, okay. That comes from Dan. I believe that then.
Okay, so my thing. You think people are going to take that seriously? We're just going to flip a coin, see which one, because they're so used to how it is. Vice President doesn't do shit. I mean, I'm sure he does behind scenes, but do you think people would actually take that seriously?
So I think if brought across, and that's the point they're trying to do, is trying to say, hey, let's have these conversations, and people can think about it, because like you said, like, well, the Vice President doesn't do shit. Well, a lot of people say the president doesn't do shit. Well, then why are we so upset about who the president's going to be? If the president doesn't do shit.
Yeah.
But president, I mean, he has this role that's, you know, mostly ceremonious, but at the same time, he's got the power to veto. He's got a lot more power than people really give him credit for.
Do you think he'd tweet?
He's tweeting it way before he's beating it. So the idea is for them to run on a basis of, hey, they're going to work together to solve. That's why because it's always a vice president and a president from the same party that have the same. And they fight over the House and the Congress and the Senate. So they try to get more people and all these other things. So that's the idea of having a left and right, so they can actually work together, particularly because the idea is if after that 4 years, they switch positions. So that's, and to me, like,
and I think that's why the coin toss doesn't really matter, because the idea is that they're both going to, just going to flip flop. So it's going to be equal as long as they win again.
Right. And at the same time, I mean, look at, it goes back to what do we have to choose from now? You know what I mean? I mean, I know you don't know a whole lot about Tulsi or Dan Crenshaw, and I don't think a lot of people do. I think they have just enough name recognition that, because I know like Dan Crenshaw was made fun of on SNL, and then he ended up coming on SNL and doing that whole thing. And, Tulsi got a lot of notoriety.
Wait, you mean someone in a leadership position was made fun of? For their eye and for their service.
Yeah, that was
blown
out for their service. Yeah.
And they didn't cause a stink.
Yeah,
they didn't get upset. They laughed it off.
Yeah, I mean, he even said that it was – I saw an interview with him that he said that, it was offensive. He's like, but I just chose not to be offended by it. Like,
exactly.
Like, you know what? Like, if that's – he's like, yeah, it was offensive. And he's like, a lot of my friends took more –
He was a SEAL. What do you think they said?
Yeah. You know what I mean? So he's like, but if anyone's, he's like, and I was a SEAL, like, if anyone's giving me a hard time, I guarantee it's going to be my buddies that I were in the SEALs with. They're giving me a much more hard time than anybody on TV could. So like, he's like, yeah, it was offensive. But he's like, but why?
I mean, it's Saturday Night Live. Everything they do is fucking offensive.
Yeah, but it was the way they did it. Like
it wasn't even about the eye so much as it was like, I think he said something along the lines of, he was in the military or he served or whatever. He said, or whatever. And people were like,
he's in the Congress. Is he? That's
yeah. He's a Texas congressman. Okay. Yeah. Yep.
Right there.
Lone Star State. Yeah. I think I want to say he's like third district. I don't think it really matters, but yeah, he's a Texas congressman.
Boy, are you from Texas?
Yeah. We don't need to go there either.
So can I bring it back? Yeah, absolutely. Full circle? Okay, yeah. So we both mentioned how our vote, all three of us, mentioned how our vote just didn't matter, mm-hmm. right? So once we finally decide, okay, this is our duty, this is part of what we should do as an adult for whatever reason, jump that hurdle. Everyone says, oh, if you don't vote left or right, you're wasting your vote. Mm-hmm. So how do you get over that hurdle? Especially when they just came about, what, like 4 months ago?
I mean, yeah, it's been...
Like, this is a fast track.
It's very, very fast track. And partly, and this is just to their defense, is they've kept a lot of it under wraps because they knew the more of their plan that was out there, the easier it'd be for it to be fought against.
The element of surprise.
Yeah, and I mean, they still... I mean, Twitter shut them down. Mm-hmm. During the last night of the RNC, they started a hashtag that was just say no to Donald and Joe. I remember the hashtag now. And they ended up, Twitter shut their account down. It's still suspended over a week and a half later, and they haven't heard a single thing. They were told at one point that, surprise, surprise, use this fucking excuse how many times, that they were reported and they thought they were basically Russian bots. Like, get the fuck out of here.
I can't do Twitter.
Like, I hate it all. But that's like, what? That's just all like the go-to now. It's just, oh, you're a Russian bot. Like, oh, you're in the, you know, Russia's got their hands in your pockets. So, like, all right, let's get that. We need to find a new excuse because it's just not working. But so even then, you know, Twitter shut them down. You couldn't link to their website. You couldn't do any of that. So obviously, and to me, like, if you're getting censored by the mainstream media and all these, you know, social sites, why? Because they're either you're inciting violence, which they obviously have not done, or someone's afraid of you.
Has anyone put it on the, you know how much TV I watch? None, basically. Mm-hmm. Has it been on?
Brett Weinstein has actually been on Fox News. He's been interviewed by Fox News. I guarantee you he'll never be interviewed on any type of left media. I'm surprised. I'm almost kind of surprised that Fox News even picked it up.
Yes, I don't know.
But yeah, that's the only thing I think he's been on.
Why? As far as, I mean, Fox News had Tulsi on, so.
Yeah, but you know, but that was, but this is theoretically, it could be a threat to Donald Trump as well. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, but it kind of, that's why it's kind of surprising that Fox News
didn't. I don't think he needs people that are going to be a threat. I think he's enough of a threat to himself by just tweeting.
Yeah, but I mean.
But if there's not another option, people aren't going to vote for fucking Biden either.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's going to be a lot closer than people would think.
Okay, but what's the deal with Unity 2020 throwing up the Hail Mary because they can't get on the ballot and they need to get the.
Right, so what the.
I saw that video, but that was just what, like Tuesday this week?
Yeah, so what their plan is they are trying to get the Libertarian Party and the Green Party, who have ballot access across the nation. From what I've gathered and what I've, you know, their first initial plan is to get ballot access by getting those parties to join them, in a sense. So the instead of
will they not make it on the ballot if both of them don't?
There's different laws and different time frames on when you have to get access to the ballot and how you get on there. So if the Libertarian Party and the Green Party say you can have our spot, then they have access guaranteed. But otherwise, there's a couple different things. I don't know all of them, but he mentioned a couple different things. He could also do some of the local parties that have access to the ballots, but then you have to go and get access.
Kanye.
Yeezy.
Kanye has like 8 or 10 states he's on the ballot for.
Right. So, but that's the next plan, is to do that. And then they've even said, you know, that if they've decided they have a plan set in place where if they get to the point where they are sure that there's no way they can get enough electoral votes, then they will back out and pull out of the race completely. And then everyone can still go vote for their respective candidate that they want to, because they don't want to hamper. That's another thing. Like, that's another thing that impressed me too, is like, they don't want to hamper, they don't want to destroy the elections, but if they have a chance to win it, like,
just burn it down at this point.
It's so crazy.
So they can do a Hail Mary for this year and say it doesn't work. Okay, well, then they have 4 years to set their shit
right
on fire.
Well, that's the thing that I think, but at this point, he's like, hey, look, this could be an extremely pivotal year. And that's why it's crazy. It is a Hail Mary.
Yeah. Do we have 4 years to wait?
Exactly. That's what Weinstein is, his idea is, you know, in that group now, they have thousands and thousands of volunteers now that are working around the clock for him, because it's like, to your point, do we have four more years, you know, before something really fucks up?
Bro, here's my question. Theoretically, if they won, dude, what fight song, what theme song are each one of them coming out to?
Oh, man. I don't know.
I don't know, Tulsi, but Hailstorm, for sure.
I could see her being a Hailstorm kind of gal. I think you really like her. She's a badass. I saw, after I watched a couple of interviews with her, I was like, oh, like, I wasn't so sure about her.
You're not. How do I say this?
No.
You're not a typical male that feels certain ways about women and leadership. You don't have that. I mean, you have a very high respect for women. And
literally had that conversation last night.
Yeah. So, and it's one thing that I love about you, but
he's not a misogynist.
No. So for you to say, I mean, you respect Karen, you respect Kate. They're your bosses, your mom. I mean, you respect her. You respect me. It doesn't surprise me that you would say, I for sure would vote for her. But it's also, you wouldn't say that about just anybody.
Oh, yeah. So to balance that out, fuck Hillary Clinton. Because there's no way. Oh, I mean. You know what I mean? But that's what I'm saying. A lot of
men
people
that are just fucking.
But a lot of people were on board for Hillary Clinton, voting for her. There is not a goddamn chance in hell that I would have ever voted for her. Like,
well, you can be a, you can even
honestly
go
just
as
saying
far
that
as being
over
a,
here just kind of scares me about her.
You can even go as far as being a feminist and still not be for all females.
Well, yeah,
like fuck
no.
her. Yeah,
but I mean,
sure.
just in general, I guess maybe with the Tulsi thing is, you know, she makes sense. There's a lot of females I would not vote for. I think I'm not even going to get into it, but. She's a veteran. She's still active. And I think she's active National Guard now, and she's actually just out doing something.
Yep. I saw those pictures.
Yeah. And like,
what did she do other than that? Like, how did her name get thrown in this?
She is a congressperson for Hawaii.
Oh, okay.
I think she has the main, the main island except for the urban district.
She needs to get them
encourage those voters.
Yeah, because Hawaii is the least, at least in the, and I think it was 2012, and West Virginia was the second least.
Yeah, but I mean, they don't have a whole lot of people either, so they don't have a whole lot of electoral votes. But
so
still,
that means they had.
Like, but I guarantee, like, I feel like she would be a sweep for Hawaii. I can't see how that wouldn't, you know. But I mean, she's a veteran. She's, you know, she's intelligent, and she is left. You know, she's liberal-ish. I don't even know how to define all the terms.
No,
I don't know what it is.
Not really left anymore. I think she'd be like medium right at this
point. No, well, if you're basing the gauge off of Antifa, yeah, then she's, I mean, she's a right winger if you're basing that off it. But I mean,
I'd have such a hard time putting myself in a category. I don't think I could do it.
Well, I think because the category they've gotten, it's gotten so. I think, and that's the point of this right here. That's my point, is I think there's a lot of people out there that are like all three of us, that are disengaged, or have been disengaged, and we're not fascists. We're not Antifa or communists. Like, I think there's a lot of disengaged people that are centrists. You know, they're, or like the Libertarian Party, like they had a pretty big voting. I think they took like 3 million votes or something like that last year or last time, which is
the most ever, I think.
More than ever. So like just if we could get, and I think what they, you know, I agree with this too, is they talked about if you could have kind of one-on-one or small conversations with people about this type of thing, then I think it could be they could become a thing. But it takes that having that conversation with people and saying, hey, like, you know, or anytime someone says something like, oh, this year, whatever, well, hey, there's options out there. We don't have to vote for, you know, have you looked at this? You know, and I think if the normal citizen were able to get that information, you know, they'd think twice. And that's, I think that's the purpose of
this. You're right, a lot more patient and open-minded to having said conversations with people. It's so difficult. I can't just the stuff that you read and you hear and left, right, the extremists. And I feel like people that didn't even used to be so extreme are so extreme now because they stand for their cause, which is fine. Mm-hmm. But it's so one way or the other. And I know that you're never going to get through to somebody unless you sit down and have those conversations, but damn.
Yeah. And so my thought to that would be is asking questions. You know, it's when you ask somebody a question, it's very non-aggressive to approach them that way, you know, especially and not backing down from it. And the same thing is kind of going sidetracked here, but you know, a lot of the conversations we've had with the particular climate of everything is, you know, the racism issue. You know, I didn't grow up in a racist household. You know, obviously I saw it when we, you know, live in a pretty country area, but I don't think I was ever, you know, I never thought of myself as racist or obviously people don't really, unless you're really racist, you don't think of yourself as being racist. Mm-hmm. But I never did anything, but I think where I had a conversation with somebody at one point where I realized that, you know, maybe I've never had racist actions or thoughts, but I've been in situations where I could have said, hey, that's not cool. So maybe that's where I've kind of faltered with that. Mm-hmm. So at the same time of, you know, with political, because obviously there's not much more divisive. I don't know. I'm not messing up the word, but you know what I'm trying to say. There's not much, you know, more than that than religion, race, and politics. Like, don't talk about those things at work. That's what it's always. You know, we don't talk. Like, maybe we should just a little bit, not aggressive. But when people say something, well, all right, you hate Trump. Well, hey, have you thought about this? Maybe we could agree. Maybe we could discuss and try to find something to agree on. Instead of trying to find the things to argue about, what can we find to agree on? And that's kind of, I think that's...
Do you think that's even possible? Going back to kind of the state of the nation. And I mean, you've literally invited people who are pretty far left to this podcast with no response. And all you said was, I want to have a conversation. I want to listen to what you have to say. I want to listen to what you have to say. It wasn't even, hey, I want you to listen to me. It was, here's the forum. Let's hear what you have to say. And just not interested.
Yeah. And I mean, I think some people are, I mean, there's a lot of things that could go into that too. Some people just don't want to do something like that. This is just starting. I mean, this will probably be the, you know, one of the first episodes that is actually advertised, for lack of a better sense. You know, so it hasn't been really out there, but maybe we'll get some more of that. I would hope so. Because there's no way that someone's not going to run across this and be pissed off at something somebody says. And if that's the case.
Yeah, because for the record, it's not that you want to have someone far left because we're so far right. I would like to say I'm probably flirting on the left side a little bit more than the right. Ish.
Yeah, I'm very centered. I would say I'm very centered because I'm very anyway. I'm right on some things and I'm left on some things. So that just kind of makes me centered. But it's because particularly in the environment that we are in, locality wise, geographically, it's a very red
area. It's a very, you know, Republican type esque zone.
I kind of thought you just wanted to have conversations so you can understand. I mean, how many the Antifa or the BLM? I mean, how many those people are Republicans, or how many of them are far right?
None of them.
So then who's driving those movements, and you want to have conversations with those people to go, hey, like, why, like, what's going on here? Like, here's your forum to talk about, you know, the systemic racism. Here's your forum to talk about why you're pissed, why you're upset. Cool. Let's hear some facts. Let's hear some truth. Let's take the emotion and set it aside. That's why I was saying we want someone who's, I don't even know, like, if that's far left, if that's left radical or whatever that is. But, you know, these movements that are seemingly either have strayed away from their central cause and have become, you know, either Marxist or have become a terrorist group or become whatever, to try and figure out, like, either, like, what was your original purpose or how did this happen? And you know, do you separate yourself from what happened, I guess? Or do you support that? And why do you support that?
Right. Exactly. And that's kind of, that's what, you know, I tell her all the time too, that, like, not all the time, more often than I usually have, I would say.
We probably should have did an intro like, oh, hey, we're married. She's not just a rando ish. Yeah. But anyway, continue.
Yeah, my wife.
I think they figured that out. Corey Parsons isn't sitting here with us. I'm not just going to be a rando.
Rando. Yeah. But I feel, anyways.
Yeah. So, you know, I will admit, as a younger man, I had a hard time. I had a hard time being proved wrong. Because typically when I argue something, I don't argue something I don't know about. I think I'm good at admitting that, like, oh, I don't know about that. You know, if you want my opinion, I'll give it to you. But when I have a thought out, structured opinion that I know something about, I have a hard time admitting I'm not admitting I'm wrong. Here we go. This will be a trigger. I have a hard time being proved wrong if I'm vehemently arguing something, because I've already thought it all out. Like, I got it.
I literally married my father.
Yeah, but
in that regard, if you take everything else away,
the knowledge piece,
Buffalo Bison, proven wrong from an encyclopedia. Right,
so that's what I'm saying. I won't argue something. Accept
it. That's,
I won't argue something.
Fred will find a way to make it not, it could be black and white, maybe not so much now. You will make a way for it not, for you to still not be wrong. I'm not saying that the other way isn't right, but I'm not wrong because of X, Y, and Z. And it's like, bro, there's no gray there. It's black or white. No, there's no,
I did
gray
think about being
there.
A lawyer when I was younger. So maybe that's part of it. No, but I guess now particularly this year recently, I am trying to challenge myself and find outlets to be challenged, because I have gotten a lot better at saying, okay, maybe I'm wrong, but you need to prove to me why I'm wrong. And I need to understand that. And that piece of me has always been there, because I've gotten in fights at work at different, you know, different places where I worked before, where I would just say, well, why? Like, why do we do that? Like, why do we do it this way? And they just freak out on me, like, all right, because I told you to. You're always undermining me. I'm like, whoa, whoa, no, like, I'm not trying to undermine you. I'm just trying to understand why. Hence, chronic curiosity. And that's really, like, my entire life, I've always been that, well, why? And I will say, I probably wasn't very good at bringing it across. I will admit that.
Yeah, but then, I mean, on the flip side, though, that just goes back to leadership. Like, a good leader doesn't sit there and yell at someone and say, do it this way because that's the way it is. A good leader goes, hey, let me tell you how it is. And over time, if someone starts to explain those things, and I'm not talking like always firing back, like obviously you have people that just fire back for no reason, but if you were genuinely chronically curious, at some point you're going to go, hey, that person who's my leader, not my boss, my leader, is explaining it. And after two or three explanations, you're probably going to go, oh, okay, all those made sense. I can, it's easier for me to just accept these things at face value than to always carry, you know, this 2000% hermeneutic of suspicion and just refute, hey, why?
But you also have to ask why in a way that shows that you are curious.
So it's
a little bit of both.
Not what you say, how you say it.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I'm getting better at that piece.
You are.
The intention was always mm-hmm. there, at least that's the way I felt, mm-hmm. but no, I agree. That's presentation.
It is easy if something just doesn't make sense and it's not the best way to do something. Maybe you don't know the better way, but you know that this sure as fuck not the best way to do something. It's hard to say, why are we doing this without a little bit of, so I'll give you that. But you've gotten a lot better. This is a good outlet.
I hope so. Yeah. So kind of tying those two things in together, and something you had mentioned earlier about, you know, kind of getting the word out there with, you know, politics and voting and all of these different things. As coming from a standpoint of maybe somebody that's not completely entrenched in politics, you know, you don't have a history of, you know, being involved in politics and voting. Because I know how I it'd be easy for me to be approached, but how do you think someone could get your attention on some of these issues, particularly with what's going on with the presidential election in 2020? And, you know, you say, how do you have those
specific
conversations?
Issues? Like, are no, we like, going to talk about so specific
like,
issues?
Like, you know, you had mentioned that, you know, how do you bring 2020 Unity 2020 up to somebody and get them to, you know, be involved or think about it? Well, you know, so my question would be is, how do you think you could kind of buy into it and bite into it if someone were to bring something, an idea like that up to you? Like, what would...
So basically what everyone's been saying, we always have to vote for the lesser evil, right? Even the far left, at least the friends that I follow on social, they said, we know Biden might not be the best, but he's the train that's going to get us where we want to go. Understandably so. Trump sure as fuck not going to get him there, right?
The Trump train.
And then you have the right people.
Sorry, there's a train coming.
Who are all about the Trump train.
Right.
And they literally love him. Obsessed with him, right? So the far left, they know that Biden, like, they're not fucking dumb. Well, most are not fucking dumb. They know that Biden is not the best candidate. But to them, Trump. He's not. Yeah, to them, he's the lesser evil, right? Understandably so. For what they want. You have the few far right who are fucking obsessed with Trump. Whatever. So those people, I don't think you're going to get them to change their mind. Even if Tulsi and the other guy, even if they're military, he's done 4 years, they're about it, whatever. So it's basically, how do you approach the right side that can admit, like, okay, Trump's a racist, he's a sexist, he's done some cool shit for our veterans, and he's really helped with the whole child trafficking, but we could probably do better. Okay, you have to present to them with somebody who is better. You have to, for someone like me, I don't even know where you can find true facts.
Right.
You know what I mean? They say, well, look up your sources. I don't know if any of this is true. I don't click on anything on Facebook. I can't read anything on Instagram. It's all fucking bullshit. It's all lies. Even there was just an article out on Trump today that I'm not a Trump fan, but it was so shitty. If it's true, he's a fucking terrible person. And I feel like it just was not accurate. I'm sure some of the things were. It was all about how he just fuck veterans, basically. Which I feel like he's done a lot for our veterans. So is it all for show? I don't know. But I'm just saying that there's not a lot of truth to be found, even when you go and try to find truth. Like, where do you go to find out information on these politics? So you approach someone with the facts, however the fuck you find them, so you can look at them. Right. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. You know left and right. You know what left wants. You know what right wants. And you have to pick, because that's all you've been given before.
And that's sad.
It is sad. But I'm not going to waste a vote on someone that I don't know what they stand for. Just right. Because they're the most evil out of the other two. You don't know. So how do you present someone with information, what they stand for? Especially someone that they don't, you know, Biden, he's been around forever. You at least know the name. I've never heard the name Tulsi until you brought it up.
Right.
So how do you approach someone in a digital world with real information?
So I think there's a couple things to that. And I think the biggest proponent for what we're talking about is the fact that you just said, like, this is what we've had. This is what it is. We're essentially being lied to by everything by everybody right. You see.
It's all wrong.
That's everything you can easily see. Everything that's being fed to.
The same article will come out and the left read it this way and the right read it this way, and it is completely different viewpoints. And they read the exact same article.
Mm-hmm.
I don't.
Yeah, and some. I mean, obviously, there's a lot of media that's tinged a certain way on purpose. I mean, most of the media. And I think for me, what was the kicker is that what we were talking about is how do you know? How do you know the facts? And the facts are hard to find on a lot of things. I'll give you that. It's difficult. But I think the kicker was for me is I sat down and, you know, I watched interviews and I saw interviews with Tulsi Gabbard. I saw interviews with Dan Crenshaw, and you listen to those people and what they do and what they say. And you look at what they're saying, you look at what they're doing, and it's obviously they're not campaigning for presidency, but I think you have to view that through the lens of,
but that's all a lie too. The debates, what's her face was calling Biden a racist.
Right,
until vice, and now she's like, "Oh, it was a debate," as if that makes it okay.
Yeah, but we're not. So we're not talking about debates per se. We're talking about interviews and
just them.
Right, but you said they weren't campaigning, and if they were campaigning,
But that's what I'm saying is the campaign is different because anyway. you look at what Joe Biden's campaigning with and what Trump is campaigning with, and you view that through the lens of the typical media, and you go, well. Obviously, well, you have to understand, like, I know what they're doing. Like, literally, Biden's taking things that Trump has said and done and a list of whatever and just cutting out the pieces. Because if you know the story, and I realize it's a lot for the normal person to take in unless you're, some kind of weird obsessive person when they get on certain things and they just take... Maybe they wade in up the nipples. It's a deep dive. But I think everyone can – I think if you kind of remind people that, well, a campaign ad is a campaign ad, and you should view it through a certain lens. But like Toni was saying, if you go back and look at them having discussions with people when it's not about running for an office or when it's not about, you know –
Yeah, and I guess like who is there anyone you trust that's either famous or if there's anyone you trust, does that person endorse anyone? And if they do they happen to endorse these people? And I guess I'm just thinking of both of them have been on like Rogan, and he's a pretty like if there's some if something smells bad, he's going to call out some bullshit typically.
Yeah, and he'll even call it out to the people he's interviewing. Yeah. He'll be like, well, that's not really, man.
I'm not saying by any means that's a great source to get your information, but those people are pretty real on there. They're pretty real, and there's hard questions asked, and
Yeah, so, and you can tell it's not like it's not. They sit a lot of times. He sits down with people for 3.5 mm-hmm. hours. It's hard to straight bullshit for 3.5 hours and not show some kind of thread
or not slip off.
So. Yeah, right. Like it's not like it's they're not on a teleprompter. So that's stuff like that is where when I saw, you know, I watched a bunch of other things too, but when I saw Tulsi on Rogan, that was when I was like, oh. I'll have to keep looking into her. Like, cause this is something that, you know, so to me, if I were to be, you know, kind of like in, like you talked about in your shoes where it's what, who am I supposed to believe? Like there's, it's all crap out there, like whatever. And if somebody got me to say, hey, check out this podcast, it's long. I know it like, but if you really, you know, really want to consider it, check this out. You know, this is one of these people, just check it out. And if they have that time, you know, you don't have to sit down and watch a 3-hour long podcast. Like it's going to be there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you got a 30-minute commute to work, you can listen to a 30-minute, like it's a lot better than fucking radio playing the same 3 songs over and over, you know, but I think it all boils down to having those conversations
mm-hmm.
and even taking a second where somebody, obviously I'm not going to talk to somebody in the fucking grocery store, some old man, you know, with a Trump hat on, like, hey, sir, have you, you know, I mean, that's ridiculous, but I think if we can take those little bits and pieces and those time, little times where if you are, you know, nervous or even scared or whatever about the situation that we're in with the presidential election and you hear somebody say something, you can go, well, I'm not saying it's, have you heard about this, you know, and be very non-aggressive with it. Because like we talk about the 53%, literally if all the people that voted still voted for their candidates, but everyone that didn't vote voted for a new candidate, it'd be a fucking landslide. Like how crazy is that? Like, I don't know, Tom, like you're a whole different creature. You look like one.
The hair's up tonight, though.
He's got a shirt tonight.
Before the one the other day, he's like we had it. It was right before I wish I would have had it recorded because you could like see it that like his hair was just like it was like looks like he just like brushed it and it was like a mane hanging out and he's already like.
saw him and I was like, oh, Tom's rocking the hair down today. And he's like, Fred said he couldn't take me seriously.
But I mean, I guess. You know, the same question to you. I mean, you kind of, if you're curious about something, I feel like you dig into it.
Yeah, more. I do.
But what's, if it was something that was crazy, what would get you to go, oh?
I just keep digging. I keep digging until I saw something that said, oh, these people might be different. And going back to what we were saying, you know, we kind of joked about the Unity 2020 being shut down by Twitter. Guess who else was shut down by Twitter? Tulsi Gabbard. So anytime something like that gets shut down by
separately,
back in 2016. Well,
was it Twitter too? Because I know Google.
It was Google. Excuse me, Google. That's what. Yeah, it was. Okay. That's what it was.
Why in 2016?
She was trying to run for
19.
19.
Yeah, it was during the Democratic nominee race.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah, it was last year.
Okay. Okay. So exploring and just until you find something or you go, wow, interesting. Like a large platform of that magnitude shuts someone down. Why? And who backs that?
Yeah. And it was right at like her peak where like they were starting to get a lot. And like she just had it may have been, I don't remember if it was right when she just roasted Kamala Harris during the debates or not. But it was right around there. But her campaign was really picking up steam.
After that, I think.
Yeah, her campaign was really picking up steam. Then all of a sudden, no one can find her website to donate or anything.
Yeah, so when something like that happens, like I'm saying, just keep digging, do your own research, be curious, ask your questions, and then you stumble upon something like that. And I'm not saying, hey, that's like, you know, the definitive gold nugget that says this person, 2 thumbs up. I'm not saying that, but it makes you go.
Someone's scared of something.
Yeah. Yeah. So why?
So how do you inspire somebody who already has been told since they were in high school that their vote doesn't matter? They weren't raised in a house so their parents vote. how do you inspire someone to dig into that in their spare time or, you know, whenever?
Or if they don't have spare time.
Well, if they don't make spare time for that.
Yeah, I mean, there's some people that were, but even then, like, so, if you got Instagram or Facebook or Twitter on your phone,
you got spare time.
You got spare time.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
you know whether you make it or not. Yeah. But how do you inspire someone to do that?
You know, I don't.
You go, hey, single mom, like maybe do you want to dive into this? Like, this person no tax breaks, this person tax breaks, this person Planned Parenthood, this person not. Like, you know, dive into that and see what they're about, and then maybe dive a little bit deeper, or try and talk to other people that you trust that genuinely have a reasonably objective opinion that have already done the research. And it goes back to what you were saying about where do I find true news sources at. You know, we were talking about Tim Pool and how he was like, hey, you know, I work for this big organization and that's not real news. I'm going to just save money and I'm going to start my own station and I'm going to literally fly to the center of these events and I'm going to report as objectively as possible. Yeah, and there's a couple sources out there.
Yeah, like finding those people like that. And no, I think Matt Taibbi's a decent one as well. Like when for me, it was the realization of, and this is just me, is the realization of what could happen. You know, for the longest time, I thought it's not going to matter. They're all the same corrupt politicians anyways. It's always going to be the same, whatever. But I think we're seeing things happen now that are unprecedented. Fucking hate that word, but we need to find a new word because that word is...
aberration? How about that? Like unprecedented is better than aberration.
It just feels like a turd in my mouth. I hate it.
That incapacity. I've heard the word capacity so much in the last
year. I just went through now 2020 words this morning. Systemic.
Systemic?
Cancel culture.
Yeah, I could see that. But, But,
you can see it flying around your face.
Yeah, what? Just a little now, a little something. A little fly. But I think realizing what could happen, people are like, well, what do you mean by that? And what really triggered it for me, and we had this conversation on the last episode talking about Peterson and Weinstein and what they went through and the kind of the cancel culture and everything that they, you know, ran up against.
Peterson was the Canadian who
professor.
was going to be charged if he didn't go by pronouns.
Correct. He was the one in trouble for saying, look, I'm not going to be coerced
and forced
to use it. Pronouns.
But really, legally. He said that he would on his own accord.
Oh, yeah, he said he's. I've
and
seen
then
videos
Weinstein
and saying,
was the one who was told not to come to work because they were flipping. Right, that's who I have.
The racial days, yeah. And we talked about on the last one, so.
Okay, I just to keep them clear.
Yeah, okay. Yes. So, you know, when watching those interviews and hearing them talk about these events and then hearing them say, you know, hey, we need to watch out, look at what's coming. And if this continues to go, this is kind of the road we're going down. This is a very troublesome road, and this is why, and these are the things that are happening. And to listen to those accounts and listen to stories like that, it was literally, because this is this, I've all, you know, in the past couple months I've listened to this stuff. And it was like, holy shit. Like, man, yeah. I mean, it sounds like they're talking about what's happening right now. Literally, like you listen to it. And if you don't look at the dates, and anybody would listen to it without knowing the stories or the backstories and go, oh man, I wonder what, like, man, that's a crazy story, but I mean, it doesn't surprise me what's going on. And then you realize it happened 3 years ago and they were basically, you know, filling up. And it was just like they were essentially, you know, predicting the future. And so that's the scary part. And then you listen to, all right, well, what's next? You know, and it's the perfect example, not a perfect example, but it kind of, for me, it runs parallel with Marxism. So Marxism is the idea that it's all about oppression, that the oppressed, the working class, needs to fight back against the upper class and, you know, the high tier people to balance things out. And they do that to achieve socialism. So that way everyone's kind of equal. There are no class systems, but Marxism is actually, they spell it out and they say, we want to achieve socialism so we can achieve communism, which is everyone's on the same level, regardless of what you do, everything is shared. And it sounds utopian and great, but you look at every single communist country that's ever been around and it's leads to just starvation and death. So then you look at what's happening now, where there are people in these cities that are saying, I am a trained Marxist, like quoting that. And if you can put that to what's happened in countries historically, you realize that that's what they're trying to do. And then you look at, that's what they're trying to do here. To me, that was the moment that it just clicked and was like, holy shit. These people are trying to literally destroy what America is right now. And I'm not saying that America is fantastic on every single point. You know, we got some rough edges, but when you're marching down the street saying you're a trained Marxist and you're literally chanting with a giant group of people, burn America to the ground, that's happening right now. And if it's continued to, pick up speed and allow to happen, and that the ideology continues to grow, that's what scared me into all this. Because I know it sounds like a lot, but I mean, it's what happens. Like that's what's happening. I don't know. I guess, and it's hard to get people to realize that, I guess, and think about that. But to your point, I don't know how to, whatever the other person's trigger is to go, oh, maybe like someone like Toni, he's just, well, that sounds interesting, I'll look it up. But to your point, someone that's like, oh, fuck it. You know, I don't, you know, how do you reach out to someone like that and to get them? Cause it's not that they don't care. I don't think, you know what I mean? It's not that they don't care what happens to their nation and their friends and their family. But if they think that, back to the beginning, if their vote doesn't count, you know, if whatever they think doesn't count, like how do you wake people up to that?
And then you add in the people who truly are oppressed, who are minority, who are systemically treated differently for whatever reason, you know, and all they can think about is they want to change. Mm-hmm. And so they're tired. They don't want to go down this rabbit hole of finding, you know, how many times you go down the rabbit hole and realize it was fucking wasting my time. Mm-hmm. So they think, well, Biden, at least he's the exact opposite of what we had.
Let's try anarchy.
Yeah. And, you know, and not
sign
that that's
me the fuck up.
And not that that's the better choice, but how do you get through to them?
Yeah. And I don't know.
Right.
And to your point, you know, to me, that's Trump is obvious. It's going to be more of the same. And regardless of whether that's Trump's fault or, and you know, we've had the discussion before too, or are the people being, I think there's a level of the systemic oppression being brought by the people that are bringing it to light governmentally. You look at Kamala Harris, for instance. She was a Democratic prosecutor, or was it a prosecutor? So I think it was the.
She was in California.
Yeah, she's
a prosecutor.
So you have what she's touted as now, a woman of color, Democrat, you know, and she wants, you know, police reform and all these things, but you look at her history, she sent more people to jail. She sent thousands of people to jail for smoking weed. And then at one point she laughed about smoking weed. So like,
no, I mean, and then the truancy thing, she laughed about, arresting single moms.
Arresting single moms because their kids didn't show up to school. Kids aren't
in school. Hey, I'm going to arrest these single moms because they have so much free time to wrangle them up and put them in school.
Yeah, and then she calls Biden a, you know, whatever, and how she believes the women.
Sided with his accusers. Yeah,
he's a sexual, you know, assaulter or whatever. And then all of a sudden, he's creepy as fuck. Mm-hmm. At least he was when he had a brain.
Creepy video.
Yeah, and now he's just kind of like, oh, I don't know. Where am I? This is my sister. No, that's your wife. Oh, it's my wife. Okay. How many times he said, I love the videos where he's like, hi, I'm Joe Biden's wife. I mean, this is my wife. And they're like, no, that's your sister, bro. Oh, this is my wife here. Sorry about that. Like, yeah. But regardless, that now you have her as the VP of the Democratic Party telling everybody that, telling, you know, a particular group of people, you are oppressed and we're gonna get you out of this. Bitch, you were the one doing the oppressing. What the fuck is going on?
So my point to that is, how much research did you actually do to know for sure how many people she put in prison for smoking weed?
I mean, it's public knowledge. I mean, it's public record.
Okay, but you specifically, how much did that do? For you to repeat it right now, how much did you look up personally to know that she did that?
I mean, it's and that's the thing. It's more than, I guess, on that aspect, it's not much. Because you can look that up pretty quickly.
Okay, but did you?
Yeah.
You did. How many people did she put away for smoking weed?
I mean, it was...
Because just as easy as left can say Trump's doing all this shit, right can say the same thing. So, like, is that even true? Like, did you look it up?
Yeah, it was like, I want to say it was like around like, it was in the 1500-ish range over like, I think it was like 4 or 5, I think. I'm trying to remember now. But I don't know the exact number.
I mean, because it's California.
Well, it's legal now, but back then.
Right, but even when it was legal, I feel like that would be a very easy thing for Wright to pin on her.
I'm just curious. No, yeah.
Because, you know, we talk about looking things up.
Well, that's what I'm saying. This thing,
you know, checking those things out.
No, absolutely, and things change.
And I'm
not
saying she's a great person. I watched the interview where they were like, you called him a racist. And she just laughed it off. She couldn't take it seriously. And she said, well, it was a debate. Oh, so you're saying that it's fine to make bold lies? Like, so I'm not saying she's a great person. I'm just wondering if that's one thing that's like,
No, absolutely. Well, I guess the point I'm making is that you have these people. I don't know why. No one does that. You have these people that are saying they're trying to be the champions of the oppressed. You got a bunch of Karens out there that are trying to be the champions of someone that they're not.
No offense to Karens.
No offense to Karens, because I know a Karen, and she is one of my favorite people. Just in case you're listening. but, like, the same thing, like, you look at Biden. I've seen this interview, so I have seen. I literally heard him say this, watched it come out of his mouth. He said a couple different times. It was not more than, I think, like 12, 15 years ago, he opposed gay marriages. Him and Obama. And Obama. And I think I like run together there. But that's the point is, all right, so people are like, oh, people can change. Well, 12 years ago, Biden was like, what? Like, what do you think? He's like 70. I don't know how old he is now. He's getting up there. He's like 78 or 70 something. He's something like that. So 12 years ago, he was still older than 60. How often do people older than 60 change that drastically? Particularly when they have been in government for the last almost, I think it's 47, going on 48 years now.
Yeah, but dude, the equalizer is, I mean, they do when you get dementia.
Oh yeah, he's changed a lot. He totally forgot.
Or they do when they realize they have a path to power.
That's what I'm saying. So now he's pandering.
But so say 12 years ago, that's not what he was for. But now he is. Are people that are for that, which I totally am, fucking ridiculous. You should be able to marry whoever the fuck you want to marry. Do I put my trust in him because that's what he wants? And even if that's not what he personally wants inside, he represents the left. They're not going to let him get into office and then say, nope, making that rule change. Like, it's...
Well, no, it's not like he's going to change the rules.
No, so it's not necessarily the specific person. It's the side that they represent, which I have also seen the Trump. They're like, I'm not voting for this person. I'm voting for to cancel abortions and for this and that, which is fucking bullshit, too.
Right.
But I'm just saying, like, it can go for both sides. They're not voting for a specific person. So Biden could fucking hate all of it. He could be racist and sexist and...
But he's doing what puts some money in his pocket.
Exactly.
Or gives him the power.
And if he's he has to represent the left, he's not going to go against that. Especially if...
No, right. So I guess my point to that would be is... Then that side looks at Trump, for instance, and goes, well, he's a racist. He's this. He's that. Well, so is your candidate. He's just maybe a little nicer about it.
Or he just can't remember he's a racist.
I wouldn't say Biden's a racist. I think he's... Well, I don't know, whatever. But
if you vote for Trump, you're not black.
You ain't black. Did you see the one where he was asking the reporter if he had taken a drug test? He had asked Joe, he's like, Trump said something about taking a cognitive assessment. He was like, no, come on, man. He was like, what? Did you take a drug test before you got on here? Were you smoking crack cocaine? It was a black reporter that was at, like, was like, hey, like, they're like, dude, like, you. At least, I saw someone was like, let's use a different drug for an example. Like, let's go, like, Jesus, man, that came off really racist. But, like, so my point to all that is
all right. Now we can't even call out a specific drug and we're racist? Jesus Christ.
No.
you pretty much can't call anything out. It's going to be taken the wrong way.
Yeah. So my point is why not have two people that can work together, can quit name calling and beat a bunch of bitches, not doing the things they say they're going to do, or not standing behind who they really are, and making all these ridiculous things going on, and actually just having two people, you know, do the job of running the country.
Then if you don't know what those two people stand for, I guess just dig in or try and find someone that you trust. And I'm not saying that person's right, but hopefully that person has done a considerable amount of research. Yeah,
something. At least give you a path to go down.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, it'd be amazing not having to choose the lesser of two evils. How about choosing no evils?
Yeah, how about choosing somebody you actually care for?
How about some patriots?
Oh. I mean, I honestly, Kyrie asked me, I don't know, 2 weeks ago, who are you going to vote for? And if you hadn't brought up anything 2020... I don't think with a clear conscience I could vote for either one of them. And I don't know if that's more patriotic or less patriotic to just say I'm not voting, but I could not with a clear conscience. I don't think I could vote for either one of them.
I mean, there's always Joe Jorgensen right now. I mean, she's not going to win, but...
Well, like, is that wasting a vote? But I would rather waste a vote. And I know that one vote's not going to count.
But that's very libertarian. That's what the Libertarian Party's kind of stood for. Is,
you know,
they vote on principles, on what they believe, mm-hmm. and they know that, hey, you know, am I quote unquote wasting a vote? Yes, but at the same time, it kind of goes back to our discussion: is they don't think they're wasting their vote because they're setting an example.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
I voted, and I.
Yeah, it'd just be nice not to have to worry about the lesser of the two evils.
You seem frustrated, Cass.
I'm not frustrated. It's just... It is frustrating. I am frustrated.
Everyone should be.
Yeah. I was going to say, good.
Yeah.
Good. Get people it out there. Be. Good I it mean, out there.
Listen, I keep this frustration for when he brings shit up, and then I just...
unleash it. I try not to.
And then I'm
as
like...
As much as can.
And then we get into it, and we rarely see eye... Well, we see eye to eye. But I can see
on basic
much
principles.
On a different... Yes.
On basic principles.
Yes, absolutely. And we both have changed dramatically.
Mm-hmm.
But we saw the same before also. Anyway, it's just so fucking frustrating. Because I feel like it's everything coming to head at one time this year. All of it. it's not just presidential. I mean, it's a huge part, but there's just so much.
You better just go into hibernation for 2021 then.
And that's the question, is like, how much of this is all because of the election?
Well, I guess we'll find out.
Well, yeah, and you know, how many times have I said, "Fuck, could I start a business right now without Instagram or without Facebook? Because I don't want either one of them. Well, I don't watch TV, but then am I just putting my head in the sand? Yeah. You would literally have to do the thinking for both of us, and I love you, but I don't want to follow. I don't want to follow you. I want to follow you because that's what I actually believe, and we're just going the same way.
Right.
And it's bliss without that bullshit, but it's not really bliss. It's just ignorance because you're not doing bliss. Because you're not doing anything about it.
Yeah, I will say I think I've gotten to the point. Finally, I think I'm getting to that point. I'm kind of cresting that hill, as it were, you know, for the first few months of diving into everything, my brain was pretty much scrambled every day. And it was really, there were some days where it would like mess with me.
I couldn't handle you.
But just realizing the scale of everything. But now I think I've come to the point where I've realized that, you know, this may be a more increasingly fucked up time than we've dealt with for a while. But you listen to, you know, stories like, man, I think it started hitting me when I listened to a podcast by Jocko Willink, and he had Rose Schindler on, and she was a survivor from the Holocaust. Mm-hmm. And like, she like kind of went through, she had wrote a book and went through her story. And I was like, Trump and Biden don't seem too bad now. Like, when you realize
all things are relative.
All things are relative. And you look through history, like, and everything where we're at, like, this is just a snapshot in history. Are we living in history right now? Absolutely. But
yeah, but going back to something you said, we're obviously not there. And you're like, oh, not that bad. But kind of what you said about could we be there? Like that whole mindset of that would never happen here. We're the U.S. of A.
Oh, yeah. No, it could definitely happen here.
Yeah. Yeah. And so that, I think that's what's important, is to go, wow, I need to do some research. I need to truly mm-hmm. say, who are these candidates? Because could it lead to this? Could it turn into this? Could it be, you know, the persecution that the Jews went through in the Holocaust? Could it be the concentration camps? Could it be, you know, another, could it be a civil war, what we discussed before? So I think that's kind of what it goes back to.
Are we gonna go to Alaska though? You guys are talking about the Civil War. You're talking about Alaska, and Rick brought up rawhide thong for you.
Oh yeah, the rabbit.
Rabbit thong. I listened to that episode.
I think you're both half torqued right now. Do I need to leave?
No, I
mean, Alaska seems Rick awfully was like, cold.
I think Cass would some like
Cardi
that.
Cardi B WAP right now.
No.
You guys were talking about the Civil War, that Rick surprised me with a lot of stuff that he brought up in that episode.
Yeah, he's he goes down a rabbit hole.
Mm-hmm. I told you, I wish I could have just like chimed in, because there were so many things that I wanted to bring back to Rick when he was like, oh, maybe I'm not a great parent because I get my kid up at 5 a.m. and maybe that's not the best thing. And I just wanted to be like, no, bro, that's fantastic. That's the only thing that's fighting off the fucking tater tots. You're giving your kid at lunch. Like,
that's good for you. That's just Rick, though. Like, he's just self-deprecating Rick.
Yeah, but I just want to be like, yeah, you're good, bro. You're fine. I love Rick.
Yeah. It's
a different episode.
I mean, it's this episode now, so. And you already talked, you already brought it up.
Yeah. You're good, Rick. It's fine. Your kid's learning responsibility. He's getting up early. He's getting that physical activity in.
So here's what I'm still waiting on.
Side note.
Oh, boy.
I'm still waiting on the fight songs. I'm still waiting on the fight songs of Tulsi and
I don't know, Crenshaw. Man. I was trying to think of a good one for Crenshaw, but I just don't.
How about Kid Rock, Bad Motherfucker?
Yeah, he's
I don't know that. I don't know that one.
Cue it up.
I like Kid Rock.
Cue it up. Dude, he just comes down with the tactical monocle on, just ready to get it.
Now I'm going to have to research Tulsi so I can really pinpoint a song for her.
I'm telling you, a good place to start, and I've turned into kind of a fanboy, but it's Joe Rogan, because he has such a, it's easy access, and, you know, and it kind of comes back to the conversation piece. It's not this, they're not on TV for 5 minutes, or everyone's trying to get a sound clip, trying to, you know, make people blow up, whatever. It's those long conversations of just being able to sit there and talk to somebody for 3 hours. I think you can get to know somebody as much as you're going to get to know somebody like that through that kind of venue.
True.
So, I mean, you know, Crenshaw was on Rogan too, and Crenshaw's had sit downs with, Weinstein and Matt. I saw one with Crenshaw and Matt Taibbi, who is a reporter. Like, sitting down and watching stuff like that is going to be 1,000 times more informative than watching Fox News or
Has
CNN.
Peterson been on there? Or is it just the Jocko ones that you've shared with me?
On Rogan?
On Rogan?
Oh, yeah.
Peterson's been on Rogan.
Okay.
Two or three times, and one time
I feel like you shared those with me before it was Jocko one.
It was Peterson and Weinstein with Joe Rogan, okay. And that was just like, you really have to sit down and listen to it, because those two dudes are so fucking smart. You like have to concentrate. It's like reading a really difficult book. You have to like be like fresh. You can't be tired. Like you can't have too many drinks. Like you have to like be sharp to even follow those two brains. It's fascinating, but. That kind of format is honestly what, I mean, really sealed the deal for this right here.
Yeah.
Being able to sit down and have conversations. I don't think people do that anymore. They living our lives in 30-second clips. So it's kind of the idea to do more of this.
This is American Badass by Kid Rock.
No,
it's Bad Motherfucker.
Oh, yeah. Bad Motherfucker.
MGK featuring?
Oh, yeah, no, that's what it is. Yeah, I'm sorry, it is an MGK song with Kid Rock. Excuse me.
Oh, okay. Yeah, where's this at? I don't...
Machine Gun Karen.
Ba 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 ba.
I've seen those memes this week.
Dude, with the eye patch on.
I don't know, yeah, I don't know if I've ever heard this.
When the lion froze, what did I see? A bad motherfucker standing next to me with his eyes closed, totally.
Tulsi just starts singing that with Crenshaw next to her.
Dude, yeah, that would totally over Trump Trump.
Right over the top.
Right. I feel like even Trump would be like, hey, that's, you know what?
Cool. That's pretty cool.
They got me.
I'll give you that.
Yeah. You know, maybe I'd vote Tulsi. Tulsi Dan, 2020. Maybe you can get Trump in the background doing the background.
Yeah,
sure. Motherfucker! He's like, I'm president. He's like, I'm no longer the president anymore. I can say motherfucker now. Oh, that's what was stopping you?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a pretty good one. Yeah.
I just added it to my lift sheet.
Yes.
There you go.
Boom.
There you go.
Oh.
I don't think that was productive at all.
What do you mean?
I don't know. It's just depressing.
That you get over the hump eventually.
You do.
I'm coming down. I realize I am coming down the other side now, where like I've overwhelmed myself, and then I realize that, you know what? To an extent, this is what people that have cared go through every 4 years. I think there's a little more riding on it this year than in the past. Particularly with everything going on and the aggressiveness of certain groups within, you know, divisions and whatnot. But
I mean, did you learn anything?
I mean, I don't know. We've had these discussions so often already.
Yeah, but during those discussions, did you learn something? Because we're obviously just repeating some of the same things.
Oh,
so,
yeah, right. All the time. Yeah.
So I mean, it's probably because you're at like this point and we're at this point, just because we've experienced that already, when you're just like, was, you know, why were we even discussing these things? Or like, what, you know, where's the merit here? Like, is this going to accomplish anything? And I think it goes back to just that dialogue in general. That dialogue in general, and just going like, how do we facilitate change?
Right.
And then that just, it goes back into what you were saying about how do I understand, like, you know, the credibility of this source. Is this source good? If this source is good, is this going to facilitate change? What do they stand for? Mm-hmm. Like, how do I bring people along with me and say, hey, you know, let's raise some awareness so it's not the lesser of two evils, it's a no evil. So, but I get what you're saying about.
Yeah, and I think, I mean, ultimately, I think for me was one big thing I've learned from this situation, and it's obviously going to keep on learning because this shit's not going to calm down. You know, at best, January. I think what they have till the end of December to officially announce who the president is.
And guess what happens if they don't? Guess who takes that slot?
What do you mean?
So if no presidential candidate is announced by January because they do mail-in voting or whatever it is, who assumes the position of the president?
I think there has to be a decision by the January 4th.
There doesn't. I mean, there's supposed to be, but right. If there's not, they appoint someone. Who? Guess who it is?
I don't know that.
Nancy Pelosi.
Get the fuck out.
I'm not.
Right. The Speaker of the House. Is it the Speaker of the House?
The Speaker of the House.
Her roots look real good. Get the fuck out.
Yeah, her hair will look real good at least.
Her hair look real good.
So it kind of makes you think.
No fucking way.
Oh, I feel like I just dropped a bomb right there.
Jesus. Yeah, because I looked at it and I thought in the Constitution it was there had to be a decision by the January 4th.
I mean, there's supposed to be. But if there's not, they have...
Because I thought there was an amendment.
I mean, the mail is weeks behind.
No, I'm...
So if they do mail-in voting...
The mail's weeks behind on shit even before the...
Fact check that, but I'm pretty sure it's the Speaker of the House and it'd be Pelosi.
I just went back... I'm going back uphill.
God
damn it, Toni.
Sorry
to drop that on you at the end, guys.
I have to like...
Sorry to drop that on you.
Well, back to your point about did you learn anything? I think that... I don't know if this is a good attribute or a super shitty attribute, but I feel like I read things and I'm like, oh, that really makes sense. I really opened my mind to that. And then I read the exact opposite and I think, well that kind of makes sense too. So am I still in the middle or do I, you know? So I think that it's your idea to have different people on here. Completely different from how we think, our history, our culture, everything, our viewpoints. I think that's really exciting because it's not just this article that's shared and you have to read it and you have to say, oh, I kind of get that. It's to be able to sit down and have a conversation with somebody that's completely different and putting them in an environment that they feel open to and they feel safe in and they feel like they can have an honest conversation without being attacked. When you bring up questions to them, it's not accusatory or if it's not why, it's, oh, why? You know, why is that? Elaborate on that. And I think that it could really, even if it's just us, your 5 followers right now, open up.
Yeah, one of the 3 that's not here is my mom probably. So.
Probably. Love you, Mary.
It's not even a joke.
But, that alone can just be huge.
Yeah, and that's...
I mean, if that's all that it is, then you know what? When else are you going to have these conversations?
Yeah. Change life.
And you know what? The people... Me. The specific person that you wanted to come on here from the left that all he does is bitch and bitch and bitch and bitch. You know, it's not the motherfucker I want on here anyway. It's not who I want to listen to. I want to listen to someone who actually cares.
Well, no, and that's the idea, it's more to have about, those conversations.
Yeah, absolutely. And if it's someone who is still bitching... And that's fine, because they want to see change. Yep. They're tired. I get it. But if they can sit down and have a conversation, like, yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah.
You know, and at the end of the day, I still might not agree with you. But I can still respect you. you still have that option, but you planted a seed that I can at least think about.
Absolutely.
So I'm excited for you. Me too.
That's what I'm talking about.
To listen to the
and I think I even said it, and I didn't even realize it when I said it in the intro, when I made that little intro video for this, is, you know, if nothing else, you know, this is just to facilitate my own curiosity and growth. Mm-hmm. But I think it could be beneficial to a lot of people to have that discussions and have those conversations. Because I think I've really seen that, you know, I've never been really involved in social media, but just kind of trying to stay abreast with things. I've seen that, like, literally everybody now, they're living their life in 30-second clips, and they're looking on, you know, and there's something to that, to see what's out there. But if you think a 30-second video, or if you think a post is real life, I mean, hell, even that, going back to Joe Rogan, that picture we showed Joe Rogan with the filter, he looked like a chicken.
Fantastic lips.
Yeah, I mean, he wasn't super pretty because he had that real, he's got that real round face. You know, he's not beautiful as a woman, but it wasn't bad.
No.
And it was like, I know Joe Rogan.
Yeah, his 10-year-old was able to do it.
Yeah.
With a filter.
So it's like, you know, the things you see on social media, it's not the truth. There's threads of it, but, and then you might be able to take one step further from that and look at mainstream media on TV. But when you have interviews that are only 3 minutes long with people, they're trying to get a sound clip. So,
I mean, you're 34 now. When I met you, you were 19.
Mm-hmm.
The amount of change that's been done, some of it was active. Most of it was passive. I mean, some of it was due to circumstances, situations, things like that. But a lot of it was just passive, just growing. Imagine the growth that can happen being active in that change.
Yeah.
From having conversations, from opening up your mind, from, you know, listening to someone who can bring it across to in a way that you understand that you have never considered before. And I think there is a lot of that. But how do you know that until you're...
Yeah, you got to open yourself up to it.
Yeah, exactly. But to have that active growth, or at least putting yourself out there to get that, I think is...
Yeah, it's a fantastic thing. And that's what I hope to do here, is to allow maybe somebody to listen to it and go, okay, maybe listening to somebody else isn't too bad.
It's a quick fact check. I just wanted to... delve back into that, yeah, if you will.
Nancy Pelosi.
Yeah, the speaker of the house.
So I think the speaker of the house would be, but her term is up January 3rd.
Oh, thank God. Mm.
So it would be the president pro tempore, which is like a senator from Iowa or something, I think.
I wonder who that would be.
Which obviously they don't think it's going to come to that, but I don't know.
Hillary said Joe Biden should not secede under any circumstances.
Republican Senator Chuck Grassley.
I don't know if I've heard of him. There's so many. When you realize, like, you think of like Congress people, persons, and whatnot. I don't know, the Congress. Well, because they either call them Congresswoman or Congressman. There's like each state has so many. You're like, no wonder we can't make no money as a nation. Like, we have so many people in government that don't have any type of profit. They're just, the whole jobs are just to stand there and just yell and scream and bitch at each other and not do anything. Like, but
they didn't take a furlough this year.
Of course not. Nancy was getting her fucking hair did.
Without a mask.
Did you see Trump's statement on that too?
No,
Trump's getting his hair did just as much.
Oh, well, yeah.
Well, whatever that thing.
Whatever. Yeah, you can call it hair.
No, two scrolls fucking.
He's like, that's like a...
She had a blowout. It looked good.
Yeah, that's like a... Trump's hair is like old, I feel like Trump has a closet like Charlie Brown has his, all of his shirts on hangers. He like takes his one shirt off and takes it. But if the thing about Trump is he doesn't give a fuck. He'd be like, I got my hair cut. So what? Like, but she blamed the salon that they set her up. But it was funny.
She wanted an apology.
From the salon.
She said they owed
that she made to open that wasn't allowed to be open. Yeah, ridiculous. But it was so funny. I saw this video. He is the ultimate troll. And that's why his followers are so, because they just love that he just fucking trolls people. He was like.
And how fucking crazy are those people?
How crazy is it that we have a president that's revered to be favorite as a president by people because he's such a troll? Like, what the fuck? But regardless, it was kind of funny. He was like, man, yeah, so, you know, Nancy, she's like, the hair salon turned her in. How terrible she must have been to them. The fact that she gave them her business, but then they turned her in. She must have been really crappy to them. It's like, I would have said thanks for cutting my hair, you know, and I would have been, see you later. I would have been really nice to them.
She's probably going to make sure that they get shut down.
Probably. Mm.
Yeah. Anyway.
But yeah, it's funny, but at the same time, it's revolting.
Yeah. It's
the fact that
that's, nauseating. That's, it is. That sometimes when you're talking and you're super passionate and I'm like,
just stop him.
You make me want to throw up in my mouth right now. I can't. Like, text Toni. I can't handle this right now.
Text Toni.
You, Toni, and Rick need to discuss this because, and I love that you're passionate about it, but sometimes you just have to fucking, not you personally, just in general.
No, you can say that. Sometimes away. I just have to fucking stop.
I just mean in general, all of it. Like, it's super important and you do have to, but mental health, you just can't
pump the brakes, super chief.
Yeah, no, I agree on that as well, and I think that's and we're honestly going to do that with this podcast as well, but I wanted to have this discussion particularly with the unity 2020 repeated the wrong one unity 2020 ticket coming out, and I want to get this episode out and so people can, you know, maybe people listen to it. But
what else are you going to do? I feel like you need to make flyers and shit, bro.
Make flyers. Oh, flyers. Oh, yeah. I don't know. We're going to put it out something. There. But I wanted to do this last one with the Unity 2020 ticket coming out this week and everything going on. And I know it's going to be a trending thing and people are going to start looking at the elections and whatnot. So I wanted to have this conversation with, myself as well of, a couple people that were, disengaged. And I feel like a lot of people, if a lot of people listen to this, then a lot of people that listen to this are also disengaged with politics. Because the majority of the nation is disengaged. So I wanted to have this one last political hoorah to kind of talk about this. And then we have a lot of other, I'm super stoked for some of the people that we have lined up. Super stoked. And it's going to be I'm sure there will be political jokes made. There'll be different jokes across the board made, but it's, when we got stuff planned, from microdosing DMT, which I'm really hoping that one comes up soon. I'm really banking on that one. I really want to talk to him. Aliens. You never know. We talked about aliens the other day.
Are you going to get posty on here?
Oh. We literally had this discussion.
I listened to that this one today.
Oh, man.
I did. Yeah, man, I love him. I just want to move to Rogan? Utah. Yeah.
Oh, we actually.
After the Miley Cyrus one.
Well, okay. Yeah. I'm sure. I haven't listened to the Miley one. But we had that discussion on a previous podcast about aliens and
I feel like I skipped over that one. I must not have heard that one.
No, I don't think it's came out yet technically.
Okay.
but from that to honestly, even all the way to business and finance and stock markets, because I kind of took a deep dive into that this year as well.
That's when I knew you jumped off the deep end. I hadn't stock heard markets? Anything about your stocks.
No, I mean it was still in there. A month. I was just learning something else.
Yeah.
And I was like,
did you lose all our money? Is that what happened?
No, we're still on the positives.
I hadn't heard about it in a long time.
It's because I started diving into other stuff. Maybe I can have your dad on here and we can talk about ancient aliens.
He'll teach you about enemas too.
And on that note,
it ain't happening.
Yeah, it ain't happening. But no, so moving forward, the future, this will probably be the. I mean, we haven't been really super, super politically centered. This was probably the most politically centered one we've done. But on that note, we'll be moving forward and doing all types of stuff.
Good, because if there's anything I'm least excited about, politics. So yeah.
No, I would say there's been a thread of politics because it's just been so prevalent with everything going on. But I our shift from here on forward will be, you know, to talk about a spider web of things. I'm sure we'll, you know, like I said, we'll touch on it, stuff here and there, particularly if something crazy comes up. But I'm excited. I think we got a real handful of people ready to schedule.
Yeah. I think they're excited too, man. I kind of told them about the idea behind it and just giving them a platform or a forum and just asking questions and learning some things and having some laughs, drinking a little bourbon.
Sometimes a lot.
Yeah, sometimes you got to do that. Just hammer on.
Ebb and flow.
For sure. Any closing comments? No, nothing at all.
Crenshaw Gabbard 2020.
I'll second that.
Boom.
Boom.
Goes the dynamite.
Crenshaw Gabbard Crenshaw, whatever way it works out, 2020. Go check it out. We'll
flip a coin.
We'll flip a coin. And let's party.